Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. Yes, I've upgraded my technology again. I've got a camera, so I apologise to everyone that has to get a zoom in of my teeth and my beard being so unkempt, as always. But we've got a guest again. We've got a returning guest to the show. I've got the Scottish diva, the diva of Scottish wrestling. It is the one and only modern-day diva, Ashley Vega. Welcome back.
Thank you for having me back.
I'm excited to have you back. You've been quite busy since we last chatted. So, like yeah. I was saying, just off the recording, it went out March 2021, our first podcast. So I'm guessing I recorded it in February, something like that-ish. And since then, you've had quite a journey. I was just going through, mainly I just stalked your Twitter this morning, just getting like wee bits and pieces that I wanted to maybe speak about. And there's so much. It's probably the most notes I've done for anyone in the last 6 months or so.
I love that.
So we'll just dive into some bits and pieces. We'll start with the actual wrestling part of it, and then we'll go with your love of Mickey James. So we'll start with the actual wrestling. So shows actually came back, yeah. Amazingly.
That was a thing.
How did it feel to actually get back into the ring in front of a crowd?
It was amazing. Like, I hadn't wrestled in probably like about 2 years on a show until Discovery, and I think it was just because I stopped wrestling just before COVID, and then COVID hit, and that was a long time. So yeah, it was really good to get back into it because I feel so much more confident and better because I've had so much time to train and focus on myself. So it was just so much fun to finally get back in front of a crowd, or like to see that many people in one room was very good.
So that was the Discovery Year 6 show, wasn't it? It was the pre-show that you were in. So that's quite, it was quite a big position to put you in straight away, of course, because you're in the background of the video. Well, no, you're in the video for the build-up between Joe Hendry and Andy Wilde, and then the six-person tag happened between the two schools. So what was it like getting chosen? Were you handpicked by Discovery to be part of this, or was it Joe put your name forward to be in his team?
Joe was having this match with Andy, and when we heard about it, they kind of came up with the idea of, because they were having a little rivalry, they kind of got Joe's students involved, which led to Andy's students getting involved, and they were like, you know what, let's do a tag match so we can establish these guys from the school that haven't actually wrestled before. And because I hadn't wrestled in like 2 years, Joe was like, listen, you're more than ready to go. And I felt so comfortable for that to be my first match back with people that I've been training with. So yeah, that's kind of how the idea came about. They just wanted to establish more Scottish trainees that Andy and Joe have been training. Because I think, like, out of the UK and, well, in Scotland, of course, like, Andy and Joe are, like, the two biggest. So I think that's why they kind of wanted to bring the schools in to see what their trainings were like. So that's why it all came about in general, the big match was they two, and then have their students kind of show what they've been taught by them. So yeah, it was a lot of fun.
It's also nice to see some of these people, like Ryan Richards, for example. He's ever since this whole lockdown started, he's put video after video after video. Yeah. Never actually seeing him do anything about it. Yeah. There's no wrestling behind it. I mean, for yourself, out of six of them, you're by far would be the most experienced one in there,
yeah,
as well. Even with 2 years out, did you find that you got your rhythm back quite quickly when the bell rang and you were actually out there?
Yeah, like it all, you get really nervous beforehand, but then you realize, like, when you're there, it doesn't feel like you've been away that long. You just, because it's something like, it's like second nature. It's, you just get back into it as easy as possible. So I was very nervous, but I felt really confident when I was out there.
I've certainly noticed in the last year that your confidence has grown. You're a bit more willing to put yourself out there a bit more, and you've shown like progress pictures of your body and all that kind of stuff. So you've been working hard, clearly, on on getting everything, in order. But that sounds weird when I put it out that way. But getting everything in motion, be ready to be back in the ring. Did you find, was it just, was it thanks to Joe Hendry and also, of course, Jason Reed is a coach at FPWA. So you got like, kind of a bit of both, all these worlds colliding, and you're able to pick and choose kind of what works for you. Was that kind of how it worked out?
Yeah, pretty much. Even though that I do train with Joe, I mean, I do train with Andy on the side as well. And as soon as I started training with Joe about 2 years, almost 2 years ago now, like, he is just, like, I don't know how to explain it, but he just makes you feel, he pushes you. He really pushes you, but he wouldn't do that if he didn't believe in you. So that's what really pushed me out of my comfort zone, and training with Andy as well. Obviously, he's recently been with NXT, so he's learned loads, and he's been able to teach that to us. So it's just like having those, like, two of the biggest, like I said, in Scotland, like, push you is, and have, like, Andy put up a tweet about me after the Discovery show, and I was like, oh, well, obviously I'm doing something right if I'm having these people actually praise me for things. So that's kind of where it all stemmed from training with them, and have people push me out of my comfort zone has really helped.
Well, and like you're saying, these two guys are the biggest, and you've got that experience of Joe being from Ring of Honor. So he's got all the experience coming back from that. And then you've got, I say, Andy from NXT UK bringing all that into the, so you've pretty much got an amazing melting pot of training that you can just take. And I'm even noticing, we've only been, what, 5 minutes into this chat, just the difference between our chat last year and now, that you're a bit more like confident speaking. You're a bit more at ease. I think after you did this podcast, you did a couple more, and of course we will get onto your relationship with the Gaw cast as well, which is obviously been a factor in your confidence speaking on the microphone. The other match we've got noted was Pro 2. You are Pro 2, officially. But there was an opportunity at Women's Championship, the Bells. I think it's the Bells Women's Championship, they call it. So this is a little bit new. So you would have obviously had experience with Harmony Sky being in the match, and obviously a little bit of Rosie Knight as well. Ruby Roberts, maybe someone you may not have been as familiar with, but what was it like actually? So in the six person, of course, it's all people that you would have been fairly familiar with. But when you came into this four-way, it's a little bit more work. You're not tagging in now. So what was it like getting a proper singles kind of performance again?
That was different because I hadn't been competing as just for me and not in a tag match. So that was a bit different. But I've trained with Harmony kind of behind the scenes with Andy, but we'd never kind of gotten on a show together or anything like that. Obviously I wrestled Rosie Knight loads of times, but it had been so long, so that was like, and she's like progressed so much, you know, she's in ICW, like she's been doing loads, so it was like completely different wrestling her because she's doing so well. And Ruby Roberts had never wrestled before, but I've always wanted to, because, you know, she's out doing things as well. So it was actually really good to wrestle all of them in the one match, because you know, Rosie, Harmony and Ruby are like the three kind of up and coming in Scotland right now, and Harmony and Rosie are both on ICW, so it's fun to kind of get back with people like Rosie, because I hadn't wrestled her or seen her in so long, and to see how much she's progressed and gotten better. It was just so much fun to actually be in the ring with them all. It was good.
That's been weird going for a point of when the shows are kind of closing out and shutting down from end of 2019. A lot of like the bigger Scottish women's names were gone. They were like NXT UK or WWE. And then since this pandemic's happened, there's now this influx of new women wrestlers through like Fierce Females, through Renegade Dojo, and there's now this you've went from having maybe wrestling the same people every month forever to now you've got this whole line and crop of people that you can get in the ring with, like Harmony, like Beth Shorty as well, from FPWA, and it must be quite cool that you've went from a point going when you started there was like the big names, and then it was yourself and Angel Hayes and all that kind of stuff. A little group out the like at the yeah. near the bottom, but like coming up, that's better. There's a little group coming up, and now you're kind of the top, and you're seeing this influx of women come through as well. So you must be just champing it a bit just to get in the ring with all of them at some point, I'm guessing.
Yeah, like you said, like a few years ago, it kind of just felt it was like me, Angel Hayes, Emily Hayden, and a couple others. And then now we've got like Casey, and you know, she's still an ICW and things, but she's a busy woman. Like she's you know, kind of the one of the most experienced that's kind of we've kind of got a hold of. You know, like Viper and Nikki, they're all the way, Kaylee doing their own thing. So it's, yeah, it was quite quiet, but there's so many women now that are training, like with schools like FPWA that have opened, GPWA, who've brought loads of trainees in that are on the network now. There's so much, you know, potential, and there's so many women to actually wrestle now, whereas before there wasn't as many. So it's really good to see how big it is, because there's loads and loads of male trainees that you always see popping up, but now there's just as much women, so it's great.
And we've also gone so many places now that have that melting pot. We've already mentioned Joe and Andy, of course, but Pro 2, who you wrestled at, when I was going through their roster with Logan Storm, just to see how many promoters are involved, as talent, it just gives you that chance of just impressing them once and just going, right, that's fine, you've got another booking elsewhere as well. So it's nice we've went from an age where, I mean, when I started watching, it was probably, hopefully phasing out, but there's no territory now. It's not like if you wrestle here, you can't wrestle there. Obviously, there's some exceptions to the rule, but generally, it's if you wrestle here, you can wrestle anywhere. And I think from what I understand from likes of Joe and Andy and that, they're very much if they think you're ready to wrestle, put your CV out, go places, get your experience, and then come back and they'll do the tweaks they need to do, or have any concerns, they can help you with that. So it's just nice. Wrestling is nice at the moment. after everything that happened, it's nice to just sit back and go, no, everything's going well. That's fine. Yeah. There's crowds back and everything. Let's go into Mickie James then. So last time we chat, like I say, was February 2021 ish, and you've connected well with Ella. Ella J, of course, of a Wrestling Gal podcast, which has led you to form, I think, a friendship. I could say that with the girls at Gaw, Gorgeous. What's it called again?
Grown ass women.
Grown ass women. I was thinking of Glow. That's what I had in my head. The women there, Mickie James, Lisa Marie Veron, and So Calval. How did you end up just? Was it just striking that friendship with Ella, and you found yourself there, or how did you end in that?
Yeah, well, it all started when NWA were looking for women for their show a while back, and I had put out a promo, not thinking much of it, to wrestle Mickie. I never was taking it serious, but I was like, oh, they're not going to, you know, be like, hey, you want to come over to the States and wrestle Mickie? I just put it out there for content, and she DM'd me after it, and I was like, whoa. And she was like, oh, I saw your promo, and she was like, send me your details, and we ever since then we kept in contact. And I mean, when she first DM'd me, I was like, oh my god, this is so weird. But ever since then, you know, she's just so lovely to me. And with Lisa, when I started talking to Mickie, Lisa noticed me, and she had joined me on a Instagram live I done, which was bizarre as well. And ever since then, they've just been so nice to me, and we've kept in touch. And obviously every week they do their Gaw shows, so I've been kind of jumping on them and jumping on Zoom afterwards with Lisa and Mickie and SoCal Val as well. So it's been so much fun to actually, sometimes I'm like, oh my god, why are they even talking to me? Because I used to watch them when I was 10 years old. So it's so cool, because they're just the nicest people.
But I was about to ask you, as a 10-year-old, 14 when you started wrestling, but yeah. when you think about that, at 14, if you've been told, oh, you're just going to casually have chats with Victoria and Mickey James just regularly, you
no
know,
biggie.
No biggie at all, that would have just blown your mind, right? I mean, yeah. It still does, as you said, still is mad. It just goes to show that wrestling it's went from this like thing where it seems everyone was untouchable to, yeah, this social media age, you can just jump on Instagram and there you are speaking to
talk to people,
to former WWF, WWE women's knockouts champions,
yeah,
willy-nilly, quite easily. It's just
terrifying
as well as exciting. So with after your chats, of course, with Victoria, Lisa, Tara, everyone knows who I'm speaking about, I'm sure. Did that kind of inspire your latest gear then? Because of course, when you made your reborn, your re-debut and discovery, it was this black clad gear with the Candice Michelle kind of gown. So it's a bit Vince's Devils overall. Was that the inspiration?
Yeah, pretty much. I know that when Lisa was Tara and TNA, she was always black leather she wore, and I just thought, I love it. So that's kind of where it stemmed from. And then obviously, big fan of Candice, always have been. So that kind of, it was just a mix of that. I think every single set of gear I have is inspired by some old school diva. I've got stuff that I've not worn yet that I was inspired by, like people like Trish. So yeah, a big, big diva fan, and that's kind of where all the ideas come from.
And this pandemic, of course, it just seems to have strengthened that. And again, with that confidence growing, you're not as afraid to push out the diva mindset and all your ideas and inspirations, because people are loving it. I'm seeing from the interactions online that they love this kind of diva throwback character going on, which, you know, it's working and it's unique. So keep doing it, I suppose. That's what I could say about that.
Definitely.
The other thing we've got is Bell to Bells had you in their top 500 this year at number 491. Again, it's going to be a podcast of me going, that's pretty good, isn't it? And then going, don't you think? But no, that's amazing. Top 500 women's wrestlers. What was it like seeing that pop up?
I never really noticed it at first. And then someone had tagged me in it. And I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. So that was a surprise, because then I didn't actually see it at first until people started tagging me on their tweet. And I was like, oh, that's like really cool to be noticed by them. Because they're doing very well. And I was like, it's so cool to actually, even if it's a little bit, people like reacting and, noticing me and things, even though I've only had, two matches in the last few months. So that's really nice to see that people are, noticing it, and it means a lot. It's really nice.
It must be just showing that all the work you've done putting out there and being able to like chronicle your story through social media, it's reaching people, and people are clearly paying attention to you, and that's always a good thing, I suppose. There's probably is bad ways it can happen, but generally it's all good with that. I'm just gonna kind of just undercut Ella a little bit, even though this is gonna go out after the Royal Rumble. Uh-huh. What was your reaction to Mickey James being announced for it?
I was very, very surprised when because I'd never saw the tweet WWE had actually posted. I just saw people like fan accounts posting the Royal Rumble picture, and I thought it was edited. I thought someone had like just done it as like an edit. And then when I went on WWE's Twitter, I was like, nah, this can't be. I was like, wow, like I just think it was, a lot of people didn't expect it. It was just kind of out of nowhere. I thought it would maybe be something they wouldn't announce, if you know what I mean. But I think because they've announced it, it's drawn more fans in from like Impact and things to watch it, which I think is very smart. I'm so excited to actually see, because I don't think they've ever, openly talked about Impact, WWE and things like that. So it's very interesting that Mickey, of course, she's going to be the one that's knocking the doors down and bringing companies together, which it's going to open a lot of doors for people. And I think it's just such a great idea to have someone, a champion from like the other biggest company right now. It's mad.
It's weird to think last time this thing stuff happened was 1997, I suppose, yeah, which is the AAA stuff. And that's even before my time. That's how long ago it was, before I started watching wrestling. And to see it happen in our lifetime is just so weird. And it means that it opens up the door for anything, really. Mm-hmm. Because Impact, I know you're a bit of a fan of Impact, of course, because of Mickey, but they've got so many other great wrestlers like Deonna Purrazzo. Mm. They've got I love Jordan Grace. I think she's just amazing. They got likes of Lady Frost, and it's a division that I think it's not a bad idea to kind of being able to dip your pocket in. AEW didn't do it, so why not? WWE's going to swoop in and have a go itself, but. Yeah, Mickey's the perfect one to kind of open that door because of the familiarity with her. I was listening to a couple of your chats with our chat, of course, so I didn't repeat stuff, and also your Mickey James focus as well.
Oh yeah,
this isn't going to be the Mickey James podcast, but it's going to be near as damn it with Ella. And you were saying that the first time I actually saw a wrestler was for TNA, one of the Glasgow shows.
Yeah.
And I was just curious. I went back to see some of the matches that I may have seen her wrestle in. And some of these matches, I think you could be quite jealous of, because in 2006, first time I saw her wrestle was Tori Wilson and Mickey James against Lita and Victoria in Aberdeen.
Wow. That's like my four faves. Like,
I know. Yeah, I was going through it in 2007. Michelle McCool and Maurice was against Victoria and Katie Lee Burchill. This is
legends.
A time
to be a wrestling fan.
Beth Phoenix against Candice Michelle in 2008 with special referee Mickey James.
My gosh.
And then 2009, Melina against Beth Phoenix with special ref Kelly Kelly. So, you know, what a amazing time.
So you saw all of those ones, aye?
I saw all of those. Yeah, that was all the ones I've seen in Aberdeen, of all places. It blew my mind at the time. now that, like I said, these people are so accessible through things like Gone, and that is just, it's
to think
madness.
That these like people are all still around, and it's just great.
So was there any indication at all that there was going to be a big announcement on these Gaw post shows? Anything? No. Wink, nudge, no, nothing?
Nothing at all. It was a shock, like nothing was mentioned. I had no idea of it, and like I don't know if anyone did, because it was just it was a surprise, and it was a great surprise because I'm really really looking forward to the Rumble now.
Oh yeah, the best show of the year always, but of course
always
if your favorite's coming in, then you know it's even better. So we'll also just touch on Jason's match with Chris Bungard, because you were doing pictures, you put up some pictures of it and hopefully I'll get Jason on in the future and we'll discuss it a little bit more in depth, but just from your viewpoint of it, what was it like watching that? Because I'm assuming there obviously was some little bit of training, what have you, because Chris isn't an actual wrestler, but there must have been a moment watching your other half wrestling an MMA fighter thinking, oh, if this goes wrong, this could go wildly wrong. But what was your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I went to go and watch it live at the Barrowlands, and it was I was just really looking forward to it because wrestling and MMA are obviously a bit different. So that was something I was thinking about. But it was just so well put together, and the match was just so good, and especially for Chris not being a wrestler, you know, he did very very well, and I just thought it was just such a good match, even though I was obviously a bit worried. It was so good and so well done, and obviously Red Lightning and Coach were there, and I just think they're amazing as well. So it was actually, I really enjoyed watching it. I wasn't, you know, terrified or scared or anything. It was really good, and you know, I would like to see more of Chris, you know, in wrestling. I think he would do very well, possibly. As much as you know, him and Jason don't like each other, you kind of have to give respect to what he'd kind of done and put himself up to. Because obviously, MMA, going from MMA to wrestling is a big jump. But and he did win, unfortunately, Chris. But I'll call that a fluke and a luck.
Fair enough. I haven't had a chance to watch it myself yet. I will have to get back to watching these things, because it's finding time. It's weird. It's weird since starting a podcast and I had less time to watch wrestling, which defeats the purpose of having a podcast, I think, when I want to speak about wrestling at the same time. So yeah, we spoke about that gaining confidence thing. We'll kind of just go back to that a little bit. And like you say, like we've already discussed, having all these pools of people to speak to and being able to have them give you confidence, and of course having your heroes speak to you as well and give you confidence, was that really behind? Because like I said, when we last spoke, you're quite shy, reserved, and then months down the line you were putting body progress pictures up, which I'm guessing from just your Twitter that was a very big deal for you to do, to put out there. What kind of pushed you towards doing that? Was it just a case of accepting yourself a little bit? Was there words of wisdom that you got that broke that kind of fog of shyness? What kind of pushed it through?
Yeah, honestly, a bit of everything. I have much more confidence now than what I did a few years ago, even a year ago. I wouldn't post things like that. I would never really do anything like that. But I think just in the last year, I've improved like in every aspect. And before I wouldn't ever say, I think I'm the best I've ever been, or I think I'm really good, and I think I actually deserve these opportunities. Whether it's now, I do believe that. I do believe that I deserve big opportunities. I do believe that I'll get to where I want to be now. Whether it's before, I would never say anything like that. But I think it's just now I've been working with people that have pushed me, like I said before, and know because of that, I know that I can do it. And I've had so much good feedback from wrestlers and other people in the business after matches. And I'm thinking, well, you know, they're not going to lie to me. And nobody would push me if they didn't think I could do it. So, you know, I need to start actually believing it myself instead of just not, which is what I used to do before. So I think that's where it all stemmed from. And I do, you know, I feel so much better in myself. And I do believe that this year I'll do a lot more than I ever have.
Any particular places you've got your eye on? I know you recently had a trip to the States as well. Just I'm assuming a holiday, but I don't know.
Yeah.
Could have been meetings. I don't know.
I'd love to wrestle in the States for wherever. That's a goal of mine. But I really, really want to wrestle for NWA, just because the women they use are amazing, and I'd love to wrestle any of them. And because I'm a fan of NWA myself, I'd love to just be able to wrestle for them. And obviously Mickey's got a big saying for the women in NWA, like the Empower show that she helped, you know, set up and things. And Impact, I'd love to wrestle for Impact, because there's people like Jordan Grace and things that I love watching. So that's definitely somewhere that I'd love to at least dip my feet in and get the experience. Honestly, just wrestle as many places as I can to get there.
That seems to be a good mindset to have. So I like this. I like that you've come from someone that wouldn't put out on anything, wouldn't say boo to a goose, and now you're like, how old am I? But now you're putting out things like, no, I want this match. I want this person. I'm going to tag NWA. I'm going to tag Billy Corgan. I'm going to be like, notice me. Be the obsessive fan to Mickey. Just get in there and show Ashley Vega to everyone that will be able to see it. That's amazing. So I'm glad to have glad to see some like this evolution of you between our first and this chat. It's just nice. It's pleasant. Like I say, wrestling is nice.
Wrestling is good right now.
We did get a question in from Brent Carter. It's a weird question. I don't know if it will be weird or for some backstory or if it's just an odd one. He just put, just to ask you if you have any shoes in a size 10.
Okay, so this, I believe, came from, we did a seminar, can't say who with, we did a seminar with someone, and the promos they were making us do were just like ridiculous scenarios, and me and Brent were fighting about not having his shoe in size, and I was the shop assistant. Wrestling is honestly weird, but this is the kind of promos that we were doing to practice, I suppose.
Is this the same show? Is this the same class that had Craig Berry admit to crap himself in Comic-Con, just out of curiosity?
Yes, it was.
Yeah.
Wrestling's strange, but these things somehow work to make us more confident, so there you go.
The Comic-Con story has come up in this season already, so that's why I'm just throwing
amazing.
It out there. Yeah,
it's so good.
It's just he maintains it was a made-up story, but you know, there was a glint in his eye.
Yeah, I mean, I'd believe it. He made it very convincing.
So yeah, we're speaking about the weird and wonderful. Then is that kind of the weirdest thing so far, other than like the mind-blowing stuff of speaking to your heroes? But is doing promos on just anything been the oddest experience you've had so far?
I mean, I think it gets people out of their comfort zone. And when you're put on the spot to do stuff like the Comic-Con story, being a shop assistant, we even did promos where we weren't even saying words, you're just talking gibberish, just to get facial expressions and make things convincing. We weren't even speaking English, so that was very weird, but we all done it and it was a lot of fun. And it worked because it helped a lot of people. As much as you felt stupid doing it, people were like, well, that was really convincing, even though you said not one word of English. So it was, very bizarre, very good learning experience.
Like that story that just came out recently about, I think it was Sheamus and Wade Barrett, were told by Vince McMahon's promo class to act like dogs. And and that was the directive. And then there was silence, so Wade Barrett just went, ruff, and then Vince went, no, don't act like a dog.
Yeah.
So it's
weird.
Wrestling is it's nice, but it's weird at the same time. I'm quite happy to be just on this side of it all, being here. But exposed, it's not only a growing experience for yourself and that, but it's all of you doing it. So if one of you are going to look stupid, you're all going to look stupid. So that's it at the end of the day. So we kind of covered, of course, being best friends with Mickey James now. So that's all cool. And like I said, this is going to come out after the Rumble, so we're assuming she wins. So that'll be cool. Mickey James in the main event against Charlotte Flair. And I think that'll just blow everyone's collective mind that it'll be them in the main event. Yeah. So of course that's going to happen. Nothing can go wrong. So outside of all this wrestling evolution, are you still gaming? Have you kind of slowed down that to do the wrestling bit?
Yeah, like peak COVID, that was like my thing. I hadn't actually made any videos in a long time, but I still love gaming, and I still do it on the side if I've got spare time. I do want to get back to making videos because they were so much fun to just sit down and play and put it out there, and people liked it even though I was just being me. So that was fun. So it's something I've wanted to do more of. It's just finding the time. I'm the worst person at like editing videos. I'll record one and then it will just not go up because I just can't be bothered editing it. And I'm just not good at it. So yeah, I would like to do more of it. I think maybe live streams is probably my best bet, so I don't need to go and edit it then to upload. So hopefully I'll be doing more of that in the future, but yeah, we'll see.
Yeah, editing's the worst. That's why I just don't do it now. Just do the warning at the start. Don't slander folk. There you go. That's fine. We're putting the rest of it in. Don't worry about it.
Exactly.
But Because yeah, I speak to Alex Webb yesterday, last week's episode, and of course he's quite good at the YouTube. He's got just over 66,000 subscribers, you know, so he's doing okay. And he was saying that editing's the best bit. So, you're wrong. You're
No,
absolutely
no.
wrong about it. Because no.
No.
There has been episodes where I've had to edit like just with Zoom crashing. I didn't even notice that our connection crashed last time. Because I was listening to it this morning and they said at the end, oh, there's some technical difficulties. I didn't even notice. Oh my God. I'm an editing genius. I figured it out.
Amazing.
But no, there's been some episodes where I've had to cut things and just because of Zoom being a pain in the arse. Said I'm surprised that we've gotten this far. None of us have sworn yet,
Oh,
even
I
though
should
we're allowed.
swear.
It's great. Awesome. So I still put this as not explicit. So yeah, the FBWA women's classes, of course, came about, and they were doing online seminars as well during all this pandemic. So, was there any particular on the online seminars, any particular guests that were on that kind of gave you that puzzle piece that you found that was like, oh, I've now got a whole load of options now because of this one seminar?
Like, so we had Danny Luna on from NXT UK for like this was quite a while ago. And she, you know, I had wrestled with her like before, obviously she'd went away. So that was a lot of fun, and she kind of went through a lot of struggles as well. So it was good to actually hear from her and her side of things and how she overcame things. So yeah, she was really, really great to listen to, and I love watching her as well. So that was good. And yeah, Andy did a lot of just coaching online with watching matches and things like that. So they were all very useful. Yeah, so like all of it was just really, really good.
I was seeing some of the guests on there was likes of I'm trying to remember how to call her now, Viper, Piper Niven, Dewdrop, insert name here. That must be something that's mind blowing to you because of course I think you've been in the ring with her and now she's again we're going Royal Rumble stuff even though it's past at this point, but she's going to be wrestling Becky Lynch for the Raw Women's Championship and it's you're sitting there as someone who's seen these discussed them and now you're seeing not only people that you've wrestled. Wrestling on the Royal Rumble, the best event of the year, WrestleMania second, now or NWA, whatever NWA is in your opinion, because I'm sure there's, I don't watch NWA to be perfectly honest, so I'm not sure what their event list is for stuff.
Well,
What's their big
yeah,
one?
there's so many, especially with Impact as well. They're big ones,
Course,
like,
yeah.
yeah, so there's, yeah.
Anyway, yeah, Royal
But
Rumble.
Rumble,
So Royal Rumble is the
yeah.
coolest. So yeah, so you would have had a seminar with Dewdrop or go with, and now she's wrestling for the Raw Women's Championship. So it's seeing things like that, is that just again further cementing that if you put yourself out there, there's literally nothing impossible when it comes to wrestling.
Yeah, because I'm sure at one point she thought as well, oh, I can't do this. And, you know, if you actually go and wrestle like the biggest at the biggest show and wrestle the women's champion Becky, who's one of the best female wrestlers ever, that's it just shows you like if you do put your mind to something, you can do it. Because, you know, she's a Glasgow gal. She just, you know, and she went and she worked for it, and it worked for her. So yeah, it's really cool to actually see someone that you've wrestled with go and wrestle for like the biggest company in the world, for like the best women's championship of all. It's crazy, but it's so deserving for her. But it's kind of mental when you think about it.
I know, I was listening to, she did a podcast that came out today as of recording with Taylor Wilde, which I'm assuming it'll be that's kind of a goal for you, I'm guessing, to be on Wilde on, because, you know, Taylor Wilde's amazing. But really, that was it. She kind of just stopped, like, thinking about what other people think and just was like, they spoke a lot about crystals. It's not something I
Oh
understand
my
or know about.
God.
Right.
Yes.
Oh,
A
you
lot
got
of
them.
crystals.
Right. Okay. What's it, right, I'm gonna ask now, what's it about crystals then? What's how did these rocks slash minerals slash crystals come into your life and how do you think they affect you?
Honestly, during COVID, like my friends were really into it, and I was like, this is a lot of rubbish. Like, and then I, you know, became obsessed with them, just reading about it. And, you know, if you, it sounds really bizarre because, like, why, how would a rock or something like this be so powerful and make you do things? And I don't think it'll make you, you know, be a millionaire, for example. But if you work for something and you truly believe it, and, you know, these are, rocks come from, I'm the worst person to ask about this, honestly, but, you know, rocks come from, like, what, the earth, and, you know, they're real things from the earth, and I think they hold a lot of energy. So if you channel that energy and believe something, you know, it can work. So yeah, I've been really into my crystals recently, so I do recommend it because it's very, very good.
Yeah, I think it's not going to convince me to buy any, but I think I get it. I think, yeah, if you see it and that represents, I don't know what these crystals are called or whatnot, but if you see a crystal that represents success, then yes, once you've got it, you're going to see it every day, and then your mind's going to train itself to think about that. And
exactly.
Any particular favorites that you have?
Yes, this one here. I've got a few of these ones, which I carry about, smaller ones. It's a citrine, and it represents success, confidence, and wealth as well. So I like to keep that with me because it just, like, yeah, I just like to manifest. And, you know, it doesn't work if you don't work hard. Obviously, you can't just hold a rock and be like, okay, I'm going to be WWE champion, and then next week you're booked on Raw. It doesn't work like that. But to think and try and believe it, and if you have something that represents that, it just reminds you every day. So I think that's kind of just a bit. But yeah, citrine, my favourite one.
That seems familiar. So I think that was one that Viper had as well. But I get the manifesting thing. I absolutely get with that, because last year I was getting loads of guests on, of course, like yourself and just everyone. And I thought I need to land some of these big fish. I need to land some of these guys and girls that are wrestling everywhere across the world. And I put out a list, and on that list was, like, of course, like ones that I didn't think I'd ever get. So your Drew McIntyre's, your Nikki Storm's, your all that kind of stuff. And I had Joe Hendry, a bit middle of the pack.
Yeah.
And I got him, and I was like, this manifesting stuff works. Let's just keep trying this. And I've had nibbles. I almost got Jeff Jarrett, and then he stopped replying to me. Because, you know,
it's Jeff Jarrett.
Jeff Jarrett. He wrestled in Scotland like 3 times. That counts. We'll figure something out. And then he actually went onto his podcast this week and was speaking about his trip to Glasgow. And I was like, fuck, that's our chat going out the window then, because he spoke about everything I was going to speak about. I don't think he's going to be that enthralled about me going, what about your matches with, I don't know, Dean Douglas, which may never have happened. But yeah, so it's that man. I get that manifesting thing, and clearly, whether it has or hasn't, whether it is or isn't real, something's definitely worked. Because, like I say, you're out there. Your Ashley Vega is making a name for herself. At least I'm, from what I'm seeing on the social media. So clearly, it's whether it is or isn't a thing, you're believing in it, so it's working. But crystals, okay, cool. I remember those like bronze bracelets you'd wear, they're supposed to like correct your balance and things like that.
They're a lot of people actually still use them, and I've not got one myself, but I've got a crystal necklace that I wear all the time as well. I mean, still quite, I think it became really popular during COVID. It was like TikTok. Obviously, TikTok's like a big thing. And there was like, which side of TikTok and crystals. And I think that's why it became so popular recently. But yeah, I suppose it helps a lot of people, and people like to have something to believe in.
Exactly. Like I was going to say like Santa, but like, you know, like stuff to believe in. But my dad had one of those, and he's like the most doesn't believe in any shit, but he had this bronze bracelet, and he swore by it, like going,
yeah,
Okay, if you believe so, like, you go for it. That's
Yeah,
at least
do
it's not
you?
drugs. You just do what you want.
Exactly.
Could be
It might
worse.
just be an object, but it's not drugs.
Exactly. It's like any time that my folks would go, "Are we not grown out the wrestling stuff yet?" Like, could be heroin, you know. So
Exactly.
watching
Just count
people just
yourself
fight for
lucky.
a bit. Exactly. Yeah. Like, I like to sit down and watch like a bunch of dudes slap each other for a bit. You know, it's
In
safe.
spandex,
Exactly.
course.
Yeah, it's absolutely fine. But no, I didn't think we'd get so far into crystal chat. I when I was
No.
going to throw it out there, but you know, that's I'm more excited. I'm going to tag Taylor Wilde in this when I put this out, and hopefully you can get this crystal stuff together, and you
Yeah,
can.
I'll just this is really sad. I've got like a bunch. Oh my God, wait. I could do like a crystal haul. I've got so many. And you know, yeah. I could do like ASMR. That probably sounds very horrible in my
Well, that was actually okay. I think when
Everyone,
you
get
initially
your
started throwing
crystals.
about, it was kind of broke up everything. But no, towards the end it was fine. But yeah, that's yeah. It's like I say, just if that helps you, then do it. It's fine.
Exactly.
Right. Don't know how to follow up from that. I didn't think, like I said, I didn't think we'd end up speaking about crystals for so long. Witch aside, you haven't got any about that. You haven't found out you've got witches in your family. Just so I can steal
No,
all of
not
Taylor
done
Wilde's
any
stuff.
spells. No spells yet. Been tempted to. But no, I mean, I wouldn't say I'm a witch. I'm definitely not a witch. I'm just someone who believes in things to. I don't know. Someone who likes to have hope in something, even if it's just rocks. There we go.
I sounded so sad towards the end. Like, just I just want hope. How's your other than your crystal collection? I remember from when we spoke last time, you're still quite a collector. How's the progress to finally getting a replica Divas, but a proper
Not
replica Divas belt?
yet. That's
No.
still one my mum gave me when I was about 10 for Christmas, and I was really gutted because obviously I wanted a real one, and I was like, "This isn't what I wanted, mother." But thank you very much. And when I put on Lucy, like my real, just kayfabe, Lucy on it, and the with a Sharpie, I think you can still see it. I tried to rub it off. But yeah, I wrote my name on it when I was 10, and I was like, you know, that can go up on the wall until a real one replaces it. So I still haven't got the real one. One day.
One
Hint,
day.
hint for Christmas or my birthday, because Christmas has passed. Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I'm not. I sound like I'm really mocking the crystals. I'm definitely not. But you know that the crystals could manifest a belt, whether it's the Divas
Exactly.
belt or just the Pro 2 Bells Championship or.
At least one. I've not won a belt yet, ever. So hopefully 2022 sees a belt, like a real one I've actually won.
So as far as would that be like one of your main goals then for 2022 then is just to win a belt?
Yeah. I've always wanted to win one, but I've never ever. I've had loads of championship matches, never won one. Probably because they're always multi person. I'm not making excuses. But you know, my time will come, and I think because I've had a lot of time to reflect, yeah, we'll see a real one up next time, hopefully.
Any particular one you have your eye on, just for I don't know, as an aesthetic
Discovery
purpose,
Women's Championship, that's my
right?
goal.
No hesitation there. That was
No,
it.
no.
Their division, even though it's kind of small, it's packed at the same time. Of course,
Yeah.
Casey's the champion at the moment, and we've had Emerson Jane and
Yeah.
Martina, which we still haven't had the gravy bowl match, which we discussed previously. So that's you know, there's a raffle coming up.
There is, so you never know.
Never know. It could be the gravy bowl match that we've all waiting for between the 2 years. But yeah, so Discovery One. Even though
Yeah.
have you ever noticed that it says Discovery Wrestling Women's Championship, not
I've
women's.
never noticed that. It
There you
says
go.
woman.
It
I've
has
never
an A
noticed that.
instead of an E.
I've
Unless they've changed
definitely
it
never noticed
since
that.
when they came out, as soon as I looked at it, I thought that's spelled
I've
wrong.
never noticed that. Could
And
you
for the
imagine paying that much money for a belt and there's a typo?
Now I'm thinking Mandela effect in myself and going, it definitely didn't. I'm sure it did. It was spelt wrong.
Is it Mandela effect, like the Monopoly Man?
Yeah, like, yeah, exactly. And yeah, when first couple of weeks, for a couple of shows, I spelt it as it was on the belt. Spelt it. That's not a word either.
You must have thought, what's wrong with you?
I was just looking at it going, I spelled wrong. But no, I'm going to see that belt now and it's going to be spelt correctly. And we looked at it and go, I've made this whole thing up in my head.
It's been a dream.
But no, as far as belts go, yeah, Discovery Wrestling, I'm trying to think of other ones that just look nice. I don't like, NWA's got an amazing division, but I don't like their belt. It's a bit...
I can't actually remember what it looks like, which is really bad because I say I'm an NWA fan. I really like the Knockouts one, but I do prefer the old Knockouts belt.
But
they all had the white one as well, which is reminds me a lot of the Discovery Women's belt. I feel like that's like old school TNA, which is probably why I want it, and I'm going to want it. I'm going to manifest that for this year. It started.
Get Mickey over here. Mickey can take a trip to the UK to visit his family, and then that's it. That's your opening.
Exactly. Get on Discovery.
If there's any company that could do it that's had Ring of Honor championships defended, yeah. Then surely they can get Mickey James in, and exactly. You can get yourself and Mickey for the Knockouts championship. That's it. That's my. I'll manifest that as well. Let's try
Thank
and get
you.
It. And Thank by you. The end of the year, we'll have Ashley Vega against Mickey James. Throw in Victoria. Make it a triple threat.
Why not?
At this point, we can do it.
Yeah.
We can do it. I'm not paying anyone, so we can dream about it. So that's. Like I say, I'm really enjoying this chat, just to see the growth of yourself. Is there, outside of wrestling, is there any particular goals that you have? Just to get more crystals and just manifest all these dreams?
Pretty much, honestly, my life's not that exciting outside of wrestling. I wanted to get in a lot better shape. I always seen like going to the gym as like the worst thing ever, and it is the worst thing ever. It's horrible. No one wants to eat healthy and go to the gym. But I've been trying to not restrict myself and being like, oh, I want to be this skinny and I want to actually be healthy. I don't want to be look like someone. I just want to be healthier this year and be more athletic and be, you know, but do it for me, not want to look like someone. I just want to be healthier and be happier. I'll still enjoy my takeaways though when I want to. I'm not gonna good old takeaway.
I'm trying to stop. I mean, that's my biggest vice. That and like fizzy juice is the two worst things in the world for me that I love. There's actually Chinese like literally 100 yards that way from my house, and it's both the best and worst thing in the world. But when you're speaking about getting to shape and not copying people, which is again a fantastic outlook to have, when you're speaking about wrestlers now, there is no mold, I suppose. Back when you were watching the Divas, there was yet
like
to be
a size one.
Yeah, you had to have size one blonde hair would be preferred and all that kind of stuff. And now you got the likes of Viper, you've got the likes of Jordan Grace, you've got. And I mean, Mickey James, she's still a curvy woman as well. So there's no body shape now when it comes to wrestling. It's just as long as you feel confident and healthy in yourself, then that's it. As long as you can do the moves, that's all really matters at the end of the day, I suppose, isn't it?
And exactly. If you don't and you look good, then I mean, you can still get there.
I set myself up there for that, but yeah, you can still be absolutely useless, but as long as you look good,
you'll be okay. Thinking of going somewhere, but I mean, you know, but, the people have gotten it for looking great, and that's, you know, that's perfectly fine too.
Because otherwise we're going to get Virgin to just slagging people off for the next couple minutes going, how did they get there? Because they look good, that's why. Steroids.
A thing,
but no, like I said, as long as you're feeling confident and healthy in yourself, then that's the most important thing. Because you know, I've chatted with other people, and any day, I mean, wrestling itself, it could be a job. You could be there full time, but you've got to remember that it's supposed to be fun at the same time. You shouldn't get into wrestling if you're going to make it like just not fun. That's, I mean,
you don't want it to feel like a 9-to-5.
Absolutely. And yeah, I'm thinking you're well on your way to just, yeah, making it a business making it your job. And you're certainly your attitude and your outlook is testament to that as well. Mm-hmm. So yeah, we're wrapping up here, I suppose, because I think we've kind of ticked off everything that the last year or so has brought in, and you're reborn for 2022. Like, say, we're going to go enjoy, I think when this comes out, it must be a couple of weeks out from Mickie James against Charlotte Flair at WrestleMania main event. So is there anything, last time you gave a little bit of a pep talk to people that maybe wanted to start training and maybe hadn't. Is there any advice now you would, after this year or so, that you would still go back to yourself at 14 and go, look, listen to this, and give them a little bit of sage advice?
Yeah, I think recently, like, there's been a lot of people who think that they're too old to wrestle. When I started, I was very young, but sometimes wish I didn't, because my body is broken and I'm only 21. But like, there's so many people that think they shouldn't start something because they're old. Like, there's people at, you know, training schools that I've trained at, and they're like, oh, I'm too old, like, I'm so jealous you're so young. And I'm like, you're not. Like, Diamond Dallas Page didn't start until he was in his 30s, and he's like one of the best of all time, but he didn't start until like so late on, and he was on, you know. So it doesn't matter if you're nearly 30 or you're beyond that, like, you can still do it if you think of something and you want to do it. You don't want to leave it until you're in your 60s and being like, oh, I want to start training, because you can't do that in your 60s, because you need a hip replacement. So do it now, you're not too old. Just, even if you try it, you know, you'll know that it's for you, or if it's not, or you can just do it for fun, whatever makes you happy.
Yeah, perfect way to end up. But thank you very much for joining me again. It's been about an hour and it's just flown by, which, you know, is always a good sign, this podcast. But no, thank you very much for chatting to me again.
No problem, thank you for having me.